Interestingly enough, Declarer, I think, was the first time, I think, that your book started jumping in time. Is that correct? Other than in Anubis Gates, where you physically go back and travel in time.
That's right.
But in terms of mixing up the order of the plot.
I think you're right. I think that's true.
That was an interesting stylistic change. What made you kind of, was it just to try a new challenge of a new way of approaching telling a story?
No, I think
hiding
I was,
your balls a bit more? Or?
I think I was forced into it. Mm-hmm. Because when you put together the calendar of a plot, it's likely to involve the protagonist's childhood, adolescence, maybe even old age. And generally speaking, you say, well, yeah, given his whole life, what we're going to deal with here is this, mm-hmm. these 2 years, mm-hmm. or this 1 week. And that, it's easy to handle chronologically. Mm-hmm. But in that book, I kind of needed to tell a whole lot about his childhood, mm-hmm. and his adolescence, and him older, and several pretty diverse elements in his maturity. And I thought, can you flashback some, you know, pause to remember when he was a kid? And I thought, well, some, but not all that. And I thought, even this business in his adulthood, it's too widely separated. You're not going to be able to jump any of these gaps. And the stuff, if you wanted to use it as flashbacks, it's too big. So I decided, well, jump around. Start here. Then the next chapter can be back there, and the next chapter can be in here. And that way you'll wind up covering the whole picture, and the gaps, which would have been troublesome if you wanted to tell it in order, can simply be omitted without notice. Mm-hmm. So really, it was kind of the scope of the story that made me use that jumping around form.
And it was certainly a huge canvas. I mean, you were traveling all over the world. You were a bigger spread in time, I think, than your other books,
yeah,
too.
Yeah,
it was a real order of magnitude in terms of challenge. It was a
heaps of research.
Yeah, heaps of research. And I wondered about that. Did you, when I interviewed you in 88, you said that you depended heavily on National Geographic.
I still did.
Still did?
Yeah. In fact, luckily, National Geographic, between then and now, it's all on CD-ROM now.
Oh.
And so you can plug a disc in and you say, for example, I had some scenes in Kuwait. Mm-hmm. So you just say, find me any articles on Kuwait between, let's see, 1935 and 1945. And there they are.
Oh, excellent.
And you go, oh, too cool. Get these two. Bing, bing. Print them. Mm-hmm. And it prints them out. Mm-hmm. And so you have, if your scene takes place in 1945 in Kuwait, here it is, mm-hmm. you know? I mean, you can look at the photos and that shop will have been that shop mm-hmm. in the scene you're writing about.
That is certainly something that is very, for me, very striking about your fiction, is that you really feel that you are there. That was another piece that you stressed at Clarion, was to make it vivid. You were the first one who suggested, you know, putting smells in your fiction, because that's very evocative of place.
Yeah, I learned that from Paul Anderson. Mm-hmm. He wrote an article in which he said, in the course of any scene, evoke at least three of the senses. Mm-hmm. And that's a good rule of mm-hmm. thumb.
I remember when you were critiquing the story that I wrote the week that you were there at Clarion, you told me,
I remember the story.
Yeah, you say, when you're talking about the toads coming out of her mouth, explain how exactly it feels when the little legs wriggle past her lips and the taste of the water, the taste of her mouth afterwards.
Well, it would be a striking thing to have happened to you. And you would remember it, uh-huh. you know? I mean, if somebody said to you later, what was it like having toads come out of your mouth? I don't really remember.
You gave me that comment, and that was the first story I sold to a professional market.
And it was because you said what toads taste like. Trust me.
I'm sure Patrick really wanted to know.
Yeah.
Okay. Which of your books is your favorite, and why? They're all your children, right?
Yeah. For one thing,
challenges.
I can't really be objective about, like, is this one better mm-hmm. than that one? Because that's kind of a blind spot. For me, I always go through and try to find the funny bits. You know, I think, oh, that was pretty funny. You were very funny that day. I don't know.
What were some of the things you learned with each book? Try that.
You learn better how to have three or four or more characters be in the same room without one of them turning transparent while you're not looking at him. Mm-hmm. It's always tricky. Even if he's not going to speak, you have to have us still picturing him in the corner, you know. I think transitions from one time to another I do more readily now than I used to, because that's very difficult. Mm-hmm. How do you indicate 2 years has passed between that chapter and this chapter? You can write 2 years later, but you can't keep on doing that or people notice. Mm-hmm. I think I have female characters participate more now.
I was just going to mention, that was my next point, was I think you've come a, you know, I've seen the development of your female characters from Beth Harwood, who spent a certain amount of...
She was in a box for a good part of the book. They'd put muffins in there, but close the lid again.
To Elena in Declare, who's just as much of a butt kicker as her counterparts. And they've become... I think that maybe the turning point was with stress of her regard with Josephine.
That's true.
That brings me to another theme which you come to again and again, which is either the doubled person or the split person.
Oh, yeah.
You seem to be fascinated with the idea of ordinarily a person is one person. They understand themselves as one person, one entity. And you like to look at examples where that's not the case, because either a spirit has inhabited you, and so you have two people inside of you, or the case of the twins in Stress of Her Regard, or split personality
in Earthquake Weather.
Earthquake Weather.
That's true. And there was in Dinner at Deviant's Palace, the guy had got some of himself sucked out, which had become a little sort of cellophane guy following him around.
And who grew stronger as Gruggero grew weaker.
Yeah, and it's got his bad qualities.
Yes, yes.
That's true. I have no idea why that is. I agree, it does show up a lot. Mm-hmm. I always
figure... The jumping in Anubis Gates, the body switching.
That's right.
The sense of you're just fascinated with the idea of somebody who looks like one person, but it is not. And then, of course, Kim Philby splitting into two.
Yeah. Yeah. That's
so
very good.
It's something that's reoccurring continually through your fiction.
Yeah, I guess it must spook me, is why it keeps showing up. I always want, when I'm 70, to hire a psych major and have him read my books and explain what my themes are. It'll probably make me sick, you know. man, are you sure? This is horrible. I don't know why that shows up all the time. It sure does. Mm-hmm. I guess it scares me.
Uh-huh. Well, it's... If your protagonist is who he is because he's made choices, a good example is the woman with the split personality in Earthquake Weather, is that you are who you are because you've made choices, but she didn't make that choice because it was another personality inhabiting her.
Yeah.
So at what point is she responsible for what she did by trying to kill off Scott Crane?
Yeah. Also, maybe it's a sort of... excuse mechanism. Mm-hmm. There's the bad me, it did that. Mm-hmm. But you're talking to the good me now. Don't even mention that. If he comes up again, take it up with him. But this isn't my fault.
Mm-hmm. There's the people who inhale ghosts. They're taking more selves into themselves.
Yeah. Actually, that's fascinating. Somebody should write that down. You're right. It is consistent.
It is consistent. Not so much maybe in Stress of Her Regard. Well, yeah, because the Polidori, the vampire.
That's true.
The vampire assumes Polidori's form.
Yeah. And it assumes a little kid's form at one point. Mm-hmm. It's not deliberate, so it must be...
And the double agents in Declare.
Of course, of course. Yeah, it's getting a little bit more abstract, I guess, as I get older, not quite so literal.
Mm-hmm. But it's, who does my loyalty really lie to? You know, am I myself, who I say I am to others.
Yeah.
Who am I just by myself?
You're right. I'm convinced.
What directions do you see yourself heading into in the future? What do you have? Can you talk about your next project? Or are you still in the casting the net out stage?
No. I've started writing it. I'm about half done with it. I did spend at least a year just reading fairly random. And it involves Einstein and takes place in Los Angeles in the Mojave Desert, and it's based on complications from Einstein having lived in Pasadena in the 30s, which he did. So I read every Einstein biography in English and put together this timeline on a computer disk. And it's not exactly the sort of timeline a normal scholar would put together, because I'm putting in the weird stuff. You know, like when he was born, his grandmother said, "My God, he's a freak. His head is four times the size of normal." And nobody makes much of that, but I'm thinking, really, was it? apparently his body caught up. And when he was a kid, he would say everything twice. He'd if he was saying, "I want a cookie," "I want a cookie," "I want a cookie." You think, what the hell is that? In fact, actually, it does involve more than
doubling.
One.
Yeah, doubling.
Yeah,
again.
They both want cookies. so it, more of the same, in other words. But it's still, you know, supernatural. Our hero gets involved inadvertently and reluctantly, has to learn to participate in that stuff to some extent in order to survive. The bad guys all get killed.
Will you be using some of the characters from Last Call, Earthquake Weather?
No.
Not really?
I mean, I'd love to.
You've got Einstein, but is he going to be appearing in it?
Not
directly.
Live, not okay. In person.
But it's the same Einstein ghost that we've seen before in the previous books. Maybe you don't know yet.
Right, like the Byron. I had two books with Byron in them, but they're not the same Byron.
Exactly. Anubis Gates and Stress of Her Regard. You're right. That's a very different use of Byron. Of course, then you've got the Ka also, Anubis Gates.
That's right. Mm-hmm. That's right. But this one.
That's another example of the who is William Ashbus killed at the end of the book. You've got two.
That's right.
The doubling.
That's right. The double. The guy killing in effect himself there.
And assuming who is the real William Ashbus.
Yeah, who only gets to really be William Ashbus after he's done that. Mm-hmm. So this one, the trouble is when I'm writing, I got to forget all this talk. Or else I'm going to be saying, well, who are you going to double here, Powers? I don't know, that guy. Let's have two of him walk in instead of one of them, you know?
I do remember you talking about, you don't like to think about theme too much.
No, I don't like to think about themes. I worry a lot about plot and outlining and research and detail and all that, but...
Does it make you so too self-conscious? Is that what it does?
It makes me feel pompous, as if I'm presuming to have something to say about the human heart in conflict with itself. Like if you said, Powers, I hear your new book's actually about vampires. And I'd say, well, no, superficially, but actually it's... Actually, those are all metaphors for the human heart in conflict with itself.
I should tell you...
You idiot.
I should tell you that one of the things that... I went to my bookshelf and I pulled down a book of notes that I took at Clarion when Powers was the teacher. And I should read you some of these. And it ends with, he said, "Don't ever say in interviews, I feel I have something valuable to say about the human condition." I said,
right.
Don't ever say that.
No, in fact, don't ever think you do. It always kills me when writers say, "I have certain things to say." You know, it's a book about vampires. What? You got something to say about vampires? No, relationships. You think, well, then go kind of write an essay, man. I just want to hear about vampires. For one thing, I think the valuable themes, if you any book, any fiction, any story is going to have some theme. It can't help it. But it's going to happen most valuably if it happens spontaneously and unplanned. Somebody pointed out to me, it's a trivial thing, but somebody pointed out to me recently, they said, Powers, all your books end with somebody getting in a boat and going away. And I said, no, do they? And I looked, and yeah, every one of them ends with somebody getting in a boat.
Which is exactly why he didn't at the end of Declare. He didn't want to take a boat out.
No, I figured I can't do boats anymore. I hadn't known I was doing it. But they get in a canal boat, they get in a, every one, some kind. And so I wrote.
Brendan Doyle gets into a boat and rides away at the end of The Newest Gate.
Every book? Mm-hmm. So when I wrote Earthquake Weather, I was aware of this. And I thought, okay, no boats. Because it would be too hokey to shove one in now that I know I'm doing it. Oh, and here's a boat. and then they got in a boat, okay? So I thought, no boats. And so I wrote it and got published. And only long afterward did I think, what did you do instead? I know you didn't put a boat in there. And so I dug a copy out. And I looked, and actually the second to last chapter, a bunch of characters do leave in a boat. but that doesn't count.
Kind of backing it up.
Yeah, that doesn't count because the point was it ends with it. So what it ends with, I discovered, was our protagonist on one side of a pond and the woman he's going to marry on the other side of the pond. And the last scene is she says, get over here. And instead of walking around the shore of the pond, he simply walks straight through the middle of it to her. Mm-hmm. And I thought, well, it isn't a boat, but but you know, your subconscious was still
rucking around in the rucking on boats in the water.
Yeah, he still had to cross water there. And of course, having noticed that, I now can't do anything at the end. I can't
Which
even
is
have
why
another
you're setting
drink
next
of
book
water.
In Las Vegas in the desert, right?
Yeah, it'll have to end with some emphatically non-boat thing.
Roasting on the sand in the desert.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Exactly.
Like the end of McTeague or something.
I like to think there's other things like that going on in my books that people have not pointed out.
Well, we'll try to forbear this weekend then. There's that bit, that sense that you're tweaking, you know, English major sensibilities. I mean, for example, the birth of William Ashbless with, tell us about that. I mean, probably everybody in this room knows about William Ashbless, but tell us anyway.
Well, when Jim Blaylock and I were in college, the school paper, this would have been 72, so it was still kind of the hippie days, and it had lots of stupid poetry about flowers and stuff, and of course, no rhyme or meter. And so we figured we could write something that would sound way more heavy and portentous and meaningful, but which could be totally nonsense, not mean anything consistently from one line to another, but they wouldn't be able to tell. And so we wrote a bunch of poems, and I said, well, okay, we need to make up a name, and it should be one of those names with two words together, like Wordsworth or Longfellow, you know. So each of us thought of a word, and it came out Ashbless. And we sent it to the paper, and they happily published it. And so we wrote a dumber lot, and they happily published that. And then we wrote a still dumber lot, and that they would not publish.
They got wise eventually.
But we would take it to poetry readings at our college, and we would say, this is by a friend of ours, William Ashbless. He couldn't be here, but we're going to read his poetry for him. Don't tell him, I'm sorry, you know. But anyway, when Blaylock and I began to publish books, we frequently had occasion to have a kind of bearded poet show up, and we would just automatically use the name William Ashbless. And so I sold Anubis Gates to Ace Books, and then Blaylock sent The Digging Leviathan to Ace Books, and they did by both of them, but the editor wrote to me and said, why is this guy talking about William Ashbless? And you are too. I thought, isn't this made up? I said, well, yeah, but that's the guy I made it up with. You know, I didn't know he was doing that too. And Blaylock said, I didn't know Powers was using the name. I'll change it. And the editor said, no, leave it. It's kind of cool. And so for Anubis Gates, I specifically had to make up official history for him, born in Virginia in 1780 or something. And I quoted from his work during the book here and there. And apparently a lot of people have, over the years, assumed
that he must really have been a very minor Regency poet. Mm-hmm. And apparently some people have even like tried to look him up, mm-hmm. which is fun.
Mm-hmm. And you've continued kind of sneaking him into later books, like Elena's last name is yes. Ashbless in Spanish.
That's right. Yeah, I don't figure I can keep saying Ashbless in current books, because I you don't want readers to go, hey, other powers mentioned Ashbless, check that out. You know, him and Blaylock made that up, you know, because they might be having a good time with it, but they forgot what was going on in the book. So I've switched it to Elena, or Cities of Bendiga, yeah, mm-hmm. which means Ashbless. And of course, if that, eventually I have to switch it again, because mm-hmm. I hate jokes that make you lose track of a story, even if they're really funny. If you go, oh, look, that's actually a reference to Gardner Dozois or something, you know? Isn't that funny? It might be funny, but
it fall out of the story.
Yeah, it's made you fall out of the story, exactly. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Like, I used Blaylock as a name for a ship in Anubis Gates. Mm-hmm. And Blaylock had not published anything at that point, so it was no harm. It was like using your next-door neighbor's name in a book. Mm-hmm. But since then, Blaylock's published a million things, and now if people read the Anubis Gates, they're going to go, Blaylock? Does he know that Blaylock guy? What is this? You know, and they're out of the book for...
Yeah, I like the... In my second novel, I named a photography studio Van Hoosen Photography for the Van Hoosen room that we did all the critiques at in Clarion.
Yeah.
That kind of inside joke, but nobody's ever really going to know what it refers
to. Other Clarions will know.
Yeah, they'll know. Exactly. We just have a few minutes left, so do you have... Oh, I was going to ask about your influences on other writers that you've read that you feel have influenced your work, or that you particularly enjoy. Maybe not necessarily, you're not trying to write like them.
They almost overlap, those two. As far as influences, I find when I'm writing, I often think, who are you doing here? Who are you pretending to be writing this paragraph? And it's often John D. MacDonald, I love John D. MacDonald. Kingsley Amis. I often find I'm doing Kingsley Amis when I'm writing a book. Fritz Leiber. Everything Fritz Leiber wrote, I really wish I had written. I'd love to go back in a time machine and give him a whole bunch of money and say, don't write anything. I've got the paperbacks and everything. I'll do it, you know. And as far as enjoy, as I know in Clarion I insisted you read outside the field, probably mostly. Mm-hmm. But inside the field, I still hugely love Heinlein and Lovecraft. Mm-hmm. I mean, they were probably the first couple I got into when I was a kid, and they're still absolute favorites. Outside the field, I don't know, Evelyn Waugh, Kingsley Amis, Tom Wolfe is a lot of fun. Mm-hmm. Actually, Hunter Thompson has been more of an influence than you'd think.
Mm-hmm. And run through with his head on fire.
Yeah, you know, if it's time for that, let it happen.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. One other thing that you said to us at Clarion was to try to make your narrative voice as invisible as possible, to be like a pane of glass.
Yeah. Ideally, don't ever be aware of having a style. Mm-hmm. Anytime you...
Again, that's that suspicion of pretentiousness calling attention to yourself.
It would be. Mm-hmm. Look at how dexterously I can put a paragraph together. Aren't I some kind of writer? Mm-hmm. It always strikes me as if you were watching a movie and the director kept leaning in front of the camera.
I did this.
I always... Even books, this happens with Kingsley Amis sometimes. He'll write a sentence that is real funny and clever, and I'll stop and I'll think, damn, that's clever. Kingsley Amis is such a great writer. In fact, there were some other things like this in some other books of his. And I'm having a good time, but I have stopped pretending I'm in the presence of the characters in the book. Mm-hmm. And I think anything that makes you stop vicariously experiencing the events of the book is bad, even if what's making you stop is to admire the author. Mm-hmm. Ideally, the reader should totally forget there is an author until the book's finished, and then you might say, God damn, that's a great writer. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But yeah, not during the course of the book.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Anything else you wanted to add? We're about up on time here. Any
no.
question that I've missed?
No, I think you've done real well.
Okay. Well, we're really glad to have you here at Arcana, and thanks very much for the interview.
Thank you, Peg. Mm-hmm.